Then Acts 8:12, of course, is wonderful. That's the text that says, when they believed Philip, as he was going on about the kingdom, endlessly, all day long, then they were ready to be baptized, and not before that. Now I'm hearing of people who are denying water baptism. That is an atrocious error. What? You cannot shake your fist at Jesus and expect to be saved. No, they got baptized, men and women. But a horrible thing came along called dispensationalism, with a capital D, and it said, no, the gospel of the kingdom is not for you. That's the devil speaking. It doesn't get any worse than that. If you deny Jesus his own gospel, you've really undermined, I suggest, the whole New Testament revelation. Notice how they begin with Paul. That's odd, isn't it? And not with Jesus. No, they define the gospel firstly from 1 Corinthians 15, 1-4, where Paul does rehearse some of the gospel. He says, you remember the gospel I preached to you? It was about how Jesus died and rose. That was some of the gospel, not the whole. He says, I told you these things among things of first importance. He didn't say that was the entirety of the gospel, otherwise he would have been contradicting himself. Or as Bill Wattell used to say, he would have been putting himself under his own curse for not preaching the gospel. No, he always preached the gospel of the kingdom. Paul did, was following Jesus. But in this passage that they always cite, 1 Corinthians 15, 1-4, he lists things en protes, means among things of great importance. I preached the following things, which was that Jesus died and rose. And he died, I think, on behalf of our sins. We believe in the vicarious atonement, the substitutionary atonement. Some of our forefathers, Unitarians, didn't always believe that. But yes, he died instead of us. I think that's a wonderful truth. If you want to confuse people, you divide everything into two. Have you ever thought of that? Jesus has two natures. God is three and yet one, and yet three and yet one. You divide everything up and it makes it chaotic. Now we're playing with pronouns. You mustn't say he or she, you've got to say it. We're shaking the universe once we destroy these means of communication. We're looking for a renewed Jewish state in Israel. You can go there today, you won't find Jesus sitting on the throne of David. Hasn't happened yet. But that's what you're aiming at, and you are going to be there assisting Jesus. Wouldn't you like to be able to say to people, don't build that tank, put that gun away, don't imagine shooting another human being. You're going to do that. You are. So you are the royal family, I think. Correct me if I'm wrong. So we've been using then Acts 8:12, and I want to mention for your memory bank, Luke 8:12, which is the parable of the sower. I tell the students the parable of the sower is everything. It's the parable without which you don't understand any parables. That's what Jesus said. So you work hard on Luke 8, Mark 4, and Matthew 13, because that's the seed message of the kingdom, Matthew 13, 19. When you get so excited about this, you will tell everybody, and you get away with it in America, because at the checkout counter, you can say, things are bad now, aren't they? But wait till this coronavirus is over and the kingdom of God comes, and they won't regard you as a complete fanatic. They may look at you a little oddly, but you'll get away with it. But how much are you telling your friends? How much are you begging the local pastor to preach on the kingdom if he doesn't? I think we have this responsibility.